wife duo who are bringing their hilarious cabaret show, This Infernal Racket, to Aussies. One half is the incredibly talented voice behind some of TV's most recognisable characters.
Grizzly bear underwear, turtle's necks, I've got my share. Puree of poodle on my noodle, it shall rest. Try my red robin suit, it comes one breast or two. See my vest, see my vest, see my vest.
And the other half has a beautiful voice all of her own.
Oh, buddy, won't you send me a line?
And they both join us now on the Studio 10 couch. Please welcome comedian Spinal Tapper and Simpsons legend Harry Shearer and his gorgeous wife Judith Owen. Welcome.
Hey.
How are you?
Oh, it's so great to see you.
Hello, how are you? Good to see you.
Welcome.
Hi, how are you? Beautiful to meet you. Have a seat. Wow.
Well, that was exciting.
we were talking the other day about what happens when you just meet your idols and how you basically just completely lose your proverbial, and that is happening to me right now.
Really?
You
need new trousers?
I really do need new trousers.
Okay.
But it's wonderful to have you
Thank
both.
You. Thank you.
Technically,
Thank you so
Sarah's meant to be saying that.
No, that's fine. I was just letting you have your little fan moment because I know you are the hugest fan.
Spinal Tap.
Spinal Tap.
Okay.
And then The Simpsons. I'm just a huge.
Thank
I
you.
Think it's the greatest work of art ever achieved. But Spinal Tap and The Simpsons are two of the funniest things ever.
Oh, we love
ever
you.
Done
we
in
like
the
you.
20th century.
Eat your heart out, Michelangelo.
That's right. That's right.
You have your beautiful wife, who is
yes.
extremely talented as well.
Indeed.
You've been married for 23 years.
Oh, is that true?
Oh.
Since dinosaurs walked the planet. But it was absolutely always a meeting, I think, of music and comedy. And I think that's the reason that we're together is because Harry is this amazing, obviously, comic actor who loves music more than anything else. And I'm a musician who loves to laugh and loves humour. So and the reason we're doing a show together is because if we didn't, we wouldn't see each other because I'm on the road all the time and this is a great opportunity to just...
Yeah, to be together
actually
and,
see
and
each other.
Travel.
Yeah.
Yes,
how does
yeah.
that love story go when you're working...
Well, it goes more like this.
Oh, okay.
No, we really understand each other much more when we're working together than when we're just trying
horrible.
To live.
When we're at home, we're like every couple, we're just bickering like crazy. I mean,
where'd you put my stuff? You know, stuff.
Well, yeah, why do you move my stuff and couldn't you get the sock to the hamper? That's
very
me. But isn't that just
a legitimate decision
that
it's never answered?
A courageous decision to go on tour with you. On The Simpsons, you are some of the most iconic voices. You're Monty Burns, Smithers, Ned Flanders, Reverend Lovejoy. But originally, I'm told, you weren't actually sure about joining the cast. You weren't sure?
Well, yeah, Matt Groening called me, and he was a fan of my radio show, which I still do.
Yeah.
It's on the internet. And I just thought, cartoons, you know, I'm
yeah,
not
this
sure.
will never last.
This will never last. It's a very industrial process, most cartoon voice making. And so it was about 3 phone calls before they twisted my arm, and... very glad they did.
That's yeah. 20 years of...
Yeah.
Can I ask, when did you find that you could do voices? How old were you? Were you little?
Yeah, between here and here. As a kid, I would put myself to sleep doing the voices of the people on the shows that I liked. So even before I had a voice that could do them, I now realize later I was training my ear to hear different voices, but I'm sure when my parents walked by my bedroom, they all sounded like the same voice, you know. All like but when I inherited my dad was studying to be a baritone in the opera, so I got his pipes. And so
I can feel your voice from here.
Really?
It's reverberating.
And then when I try to really...
You know what's really bizarre in life about, and this whole thing, I always talk about it a lot in the show, about the strangeness of how people meet. Mm. It's the sliding doors thing, you know, the fact that Harry's father was training to be an opera singer. My father was an opera singer at Covent Garden in London. Harry hates opera, I love it. So that's another show altogether. But I mean, but the point is these strange things that bring people together. I mean, it's amazing. Amazing.
And how was it for you when you're going along doing one thing and Harry's obviously doing Spinal Tap, The Simpsons, all that other stuff? Is it, when you're going off in different directions, is it hard on the marriage?
No.
No, not at all. I mean, the thing is, we don't have children. We have Labradors, which is why I love that clip so much of the kid being taken down by the dog.
Yeah.
How can you not love dogs, really? I can't speak to people who don't like dogs or food.
Yeah.
But seriously, it's that thing where if you're doing the thing that you live to do and it's the love of your life, apart from, you know, your significant other, I'm really happy to see people adore Harry for it. They should, you know, be thrilled by the work that he's done and be so happy to meet him. And Harry's always been my biggest fan and biggest supporter. So
yeah,
I'm on the road all the time.
First time I saw her, she was singing, and that was what made me go boing in the first place. But
and I met him in the guise of Derek Smalls when he had all the
facial hair. Right, yes,
yes. We were touring.
Very rock and roll.
Yeah.
So it's always been
but, you know,
and surreal.
If you're lucky enough to be doing the thing you love, then you're much more likely to be happy.
And speaking of great love stories, you play both Montgomery Burns and Waylon Smithers.
Yes, I do.
And, oh, God, that's good.
It is the great love
What's it like when you actually have to have a conversation with yourself?
Well, it's very much like somebody talking and...
then the next person talking.
Unbelievable.
Thank you very much.
Do you get annoyed? Do people say to you, do the voice, do the voice? And does that annoy you?
You mean like that?
No.
It's people are usually very nice about it. It's not a... I have just the right amount of fame, you know. We don't have to travel... I shouldn't say this, but we don't have to travel with giant entourages and stuff. And we were once with a huge movie star whose name I don't need to mention, and he was walking around surrounded by about 20 people. Mm. And it's just, you're not experiencing real life in that way.
It's not fun.
Of course, Nigel Smalls, you can't say the same about that.
Derek
Smalls, sorry. When he was... because he described himself as Christopher St. Hubbins, and there was Nigel, and there were fire and ice, and Derek described himself as the lukewarm water.
Yeah. Well, that really is the bass player's mentality, you know. They're not the guys who love to stand up in the front of the stage. They're the guys who stand in the back, and the guitar players get all the girls, you know. So that's very much the bass player life.
When the most inspired scene of Derek's, obviously, is when he sets off the airport metal detector with a foreign object down his pants, which, of course, compulsory for any rock and roller. Has to have the... whose idea was that, to put the zucchini and alfoil down your...
You are very good, because a lot of people make the mistake of thinking it's a cucumber.
No.
Which would real, you are a real fan.
Yeah, because it would be much more warty and not for the desired effect.
Yeah. I know zucchini when I see one.
You do indeed. it was really all of us together. Christopher Guest, Rob Reiner, Michael McKean, and I wrote the picture together, and so it's hard to separate out which one had any particular idea, because we were all just tossing ideas back and forth so fast.
So far, and you did it all without scripts, didn't you? You
sort all of improvised.
Just improvise it,
much like we're doing now.
That's right. Yeah. There we go. And you're playing the instruments as well. You actually play.
Yes, we all
songs
in that movie, and also we did
in the Mighty Wind,
where I'm playing the upright bass.
Yeah. And, my father was a folk singer, so I felt like it was almost a biopic.
Oh yeah. No, we were
great
very
tragedy.
Very much imbued with that music growing up, and so it was sort of a not a love letter, but
absolutely bang on.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We tried to be
on.
Very accurate.
Yeah.
But we always try to write music that is fun to play and is toe tapping, even though we're making fun of it.
Yeah. Well, they're good songs.
Yeah.
They also just happen to be incredibly funny.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, Big Bottoms, that's going to last the test of time.
We are doing a totally different version of that as the climax of our cabaret show in Adelaide and Brizzy.
Yeah. We're actually holding, it's going to be a bit of a surprise, but it is a very, very different interpretation of Big Bottom.
Wow. Talk about bum cakes, my girl's got them.
Indeed.
Now, speaking of music, Judith, you have a brand new album out.
I do. Somebody's Child.
I've got it.
Thank you.
There I am.
I get to.
You're a trained professional.
There I am with the fabulous Leland Sklar, who you will know from James Taylor, Carole King, everybody ever says it's incredible. He's the bass player in our band for these shows and on my CD.
Your wonderful CD, which I'm holding up.
I'm glad that I get to come over here, promote this, and I got the most incredible rave from the Australians, so I'm really thrilled about all of this. Then I get to play many of the songs in this show that we're doing together. But it's getting a lot of love, and I'm just thrilled to bits. I do an industry show. I come back and do another industry show here. I think it is next Tuesday, but I'm having the best imaginable time.
Yeah, fantastic. I tell you what, there is no way that you guys have been married 23 years based on the picture on the
You know what? Photography is a marvelous
thing. Cradle snatcher.
And speaking of sort of where it all begins, you guys are obviously, you know, your legend status now, but you got your start on SNL on Saturday Night Live.
No, I got my start as a child actor.
My God.
Yeah.
And you, turned out sane.
I turned out sane. Well, until I mowed down the studio audience after this performance.
Did you do movies? Or
did movies. I did radio and television. I spent 8 years working with the great Mr. Jack Benny. I started in show business at the top. I've been working my way down ever since. But then I came back and did Saturday Night Live.
SNL
which launched a huge number of careers. What do you think of the current mob now? Is it still that sort of hit machine?
If you work in the sausage factory, you don't eat the sausage.
I'm going to ponder that.
Well, you don't watch it, that's the point. It's just like, I don't think we particularly watch any television, is the truth. Harry's sort of I describe him in our show as being a self-filling pit.
Right.
Because it's just like, every other entertainer like me is a bottomless pit of need that needs to, see and, be loved. But Harry just creates so much stuff. He just keeps creating,
Keeps and, Harry, you're a bit of a big fan of Australia.
Yes, I've been here a number of times. I've worked a number of shows with the Working Dog crew.
Oh, how funny are they?
They're wonderful.
Aren't they genius?
They
are so
I came down and first worked with them on Frontline, where I was...
We want to show you the clip. Have a look.
You seen this? It's a buddy of mine from the States taped this afternoon. Good interview.
No.
What?
You've taped this?
Yeah.
This afternoon?
Yeah.
Mike's jacket.
Mm. Martin D'Estasio with that report. Mike.
Thanks, Brooke. Well, with the trade war between Japan and the US remaining at a standoff, what are the implications for Australia? Joining us live via satellite is Frontline's Washington correspondent, Lewis Benton. Lewis, thanks for joining us. Now, with the trade war set to escalate, what signals are coming out of the White House?
Do you think anyone noticed?
No.
Really?
Provided they're watching black and white TV. Bad reception.
How big a share of the audience is there?
That would never, ever happen in television in real life.
His whole point as an American consultant coming down to fix Frontline was, make the set more orange.
And it's just it's so true. It might as well be a documentary.
Yeah. I've worked on the panel with them a lot. And,
just did. Incredible
Have you been
people.
Paying attention night before last?
What do you think of Aussie humour compared to American kind of gags?
Well, American humour is a little broad compared to the rest of the world. I think Aussie humour... We're huge fans of Kath and Kim, all Aussie Adventures, Glenn Robbins, all those people, Magda. So we think there's a lot of very funny stuff going on.
I actually think, honestly, as a Brit, I think that the best of Brit and America puts combined is... That's the feeling of Australia. I mean, we are huge fans. And I have to say, one of the highlights for me was doing a show, a charity thing in Melbourne, and having Jane and Gina, Kath and Kim, stand up and go, Jude, you're a horn bag.
To me, that was just Judith's album, Everybody's Child, is out now. And if you want to catch Judith Owen and Harry Shearer in This Infernal Racket, they'll be performing on Sunday at the Queensland Cabaret Festival, as well on Thursday the 16th and Friday the 17th of June at the Adelaide Cabaret Festival. All the details will be on our website. They'll be on our screen very shortly too. Judith and Harry, thank you so much
thank
for joining us.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you very much. Like it. Oh. Great to have you.